It really pushed us to higher levels of achievement. Race to the Top then came in, and it overloaded us with strategy after strategy. But looking at the positive side, it gave us a full tool belt of strategies on how to move schools. And here we are today. We are in the era of innovation, as Tony Wagner calls it. And we are ready to keep pace with the world. And so we're stepping foot into this. My name is Shannon Goo, and I'm the president of the Hawaii Elementary and Middle School Administrators Association, HEMSA. And I'd like to introduce our other presenters, and that's Lorilei Aiwohi, who is president of the Hawaii Association of Secondary School Administrators. I'll put a big hand for Lorilei. Also presenting with us is our executive director for HEMSA, and that's Naomi Matsuzaki, former Principal of the Year. Also Principal of the Year, actually currently Principal of the Year, is Mike Carano, who's also on our board. There are some very important people in our audience as well, and we'll get to some of them in a little bit, but I did want to recognize Complex Area Superintendent Donna Lum Kagawa. Today we're going to talk about empowerment at the school level, and Donna really gets empowerment. Okay, so the mantra, the one word mantra, is empowerment for this conference, but it's also for our professions as principals. And so three different factors have made this possible, pretty big factors, and the first one is ESSA. So about 13 months ago, President Obama signed this act into law, Every Student Succeeds Act. And we like to say it's ESSA, but pronounce it ESSA. And so this was really huge because for the first time in history, in an act, the word principal was used not just once, but 167 times. And that really speaks to the empowerment. The next thing that helped our empowerment and helped us get to this point is actually the work of the Educational Institute of Hawaii. And so many people were bold and courageous, spoke out against things that they did not agree with in the system, and it really paved the way for us, and they were really catalysts of change, as Roberta Mayor put it so eloquently earlier. So these are some of the people that helped us to move forward. The other thing that came forth that helped us to have a voice was the governor's educational task force. So we set up town hall meetings, and we took full advantage of them and had a voice, and we wanted to extend that even further. So which brings us to today, our principal's voice, and unifying that over the last 6 months. So the two organizations got together, and I'm going to turn it over to Lorilei Aiwohi to share our journey.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. So happy. So NASSP and NAESP, which are our national organizations, invited HASA boards and HEMSA boards to Washington, D.C., as well as Mike, for him being the Principal of the Year. And we were able to get a lot of information. They gave us a lot of information. We went to the Senate and our councils, and they broke down the law for us and stressed how important that 167 times that principle is in a law that never happened before. And so they expressed how important it is for us to get the principal's voice heard. So we came back from DC and we got together, HEMSA and HASA, and thought about how can we open up the doors for us to get principal's voice and an understanding of what ESSA allows or the opportunity it's going to give us in this system. So we had a meeting at Wanalua. It was open. I think we had 30 principals come in, and we started a process to gather our voices. And what we found, we had several meetings after that, I'd say about nine already. We found that all of the principals had different stories, but it all came down to the same struggles, frustrations, and challenges. So we went through a process to find out what our analysis of our gaps were, what the root causes, and what our findings. And our goal of this was to be part of the solution. But because we struggled with No Child Left Behind, though we learned a lot of things and it left us with a lot of positives, so did Race to the Top. It was a struggle for us to implement at the school level. So our goal was to have whoever's writing the plan to implement in our schools to hear us about what it was that we need and what it is that we cannot possibly get done. And then as we had our meetings, our number one thing was being able to collaborate and hear from other principals. And we realized then that that is the start of our empowerment, that we need to have those opportunities continuously happen. So we're still going through the process, and Mike is going to explain what that looked like. And we can ask, he'll give us the solutions and engage us in an activity that you'll enjoy. So Mike Carano.
Can't hear.
Yeah.
Okay. So also part of the empowerment, right? So part of the title of this conference is innovation. So I thought I'd just start by, so what's so innovative, right? The status quo, we talk about it at Washington School all the time, the pull of status quo is so strong, right? That even though you have some idea of, you know, what you'd like to try or something different that you'd like to do, the power of that pull to remain status quo in an organization, in a bureaucracy, is so strong that it kind of stifles, right? So we talk about all the time that innovation has to happen on the fringe, okay, where it's away from the status quo, right? So that then ideas, new ideas, and new solutions to problems can percolate and then start to change what we do in the system, okay? So one of the things about status quo is, you know, people always have talked forever about collaboration, about student voice, teacher voice, principal voice, right? And generally the way you get it is kind of in two ways, okay? So one is a survey, right? Another is then you pick representatives to come to a meeting to represent your group and you get voice. Now, I'm sitting here. My mentor is Marcia Allegri. She's the one, and I'm totally laying this on her. She hated to do surveys. And I totally picked up on her inability to do surveys, so I rarely do them myself. Right? But part of it is because, so you fill out a survey, right? Turn it in, and then somebody, some people, some group of people do something with it, and then come up with some results. Right, and then they come out and they tell you, okay, well, here's what the survey said. Right, and that's sort of what we're all used to doing. Same thing when I've been a representative that sits on a committee, right, and they ask us questions. So as a principal, you know, what do you think? So I share my ideas, right? And then all those ideas, you know, they're captured, they're written on the paper, chart paper, right? Go somewhere, people look at it. Right? People decide kind of what does all that mean. Right? And then they come out and they tell you. Right? So and then they say, well, yeah, we had input, we had principal input, right? We had teacher input, we had student input. Here's what it all is, here's what we're gonna do. And so then you get the strategic plan, whatever plan that's coming out, whatever new idea is coming out, and now that's what we're gonna do. Okay? And that's status quo, right? So what we're trying to do with this innovation piece is there are processes that are different from what I just described that can actually then result in actual voice of whatever group you're trying to get, right? That may or may not be different from the results we get, but at least there's a better way of ensuring that that voice is being heard, Now let me stop right here and just say real quick. We have great people in our department, right? 99.9% of people in the DOE are great, well-meaning, well-intentioned people. They want to do the best for kids. I have no doubt, right? But the thing that we're talking about is flawed processes, right? That people use, good people use, right, in our system that persists because status quo keeps pulling them back to the same thing. Okay, so the process that we learned from at Washington, right, and we call it pushing, which actually translates to shiny metal pointing direction, like a compass, right? And our mentor at Washington was Dr. Rhea Shuro, who's a retired UH professor from public health. But he looked at stuff that was actually started out by Edward Deming, you know, Toyota production system, and Tony Wagner's book actually cites that as one of the process that you use to improve the Toyota car or make a model, right? And we've applied it at all different levels within our students. So we actually have students that have learned this process and use it to look at like what would make the school better, right? That we actually believe is the voice of students as they go through the process. So when HEMSA and HASA came to me and said, well, we'd like to kind of look at this idea of principal voice, right? I was able to bring a team of teachers. There we go. So those are all teachers or former teachers. Just has moved on to Evans High Middle School. We've used that process in school, right? And Tracy and Mark, Tracy Shintaku, Mark Nimoto are our lead facilitators on it, right? So I was able to bring them to the principal's meeting and they led then the principal's through the process. Okay, get back to the story. So when we were having this opportunity with ESSA, right, and both the Governor's Task Force and the DOE were getting these large groups of community, teachers, principals to come and provide input. Okay, the status quo, right? So instead of having small groups of people come and meet, now they had these large groups of people come and meet. So 3,000 people or how many of 1,000 people came to the Governor's Summer, which again, great people. But what happened is I went there, I wrote post-it notes, right? We gave input, right? Once we gave input, what I did is I went home, right? Never interacted again with any of that committee. Somebody, well-meaning people, took all that input, thousands of people, right? And came up with ideas, right? Don't know whether they were my ideas, right? But I did the analysis and worked it out, right? And came up with their blueprint, right? Just like DOE did the same thing, principals, community, hundreds and thousands, maybe people came to all those different meetings, right? Filled out post-it notes, wrote on the paper, right? Was all gathered, taken somewhere, they worked on it, came up with a strategic plan, okay? So, on one hand, could they say principal voice was included? Well, sure, right? Principals were there, we gave input. But we had no other role in that other than to receive whatever somebody decided was what we said. Okay, so I'm gonna describe the push-in process that we feel actually has the people that give the input do the analysis. Okay, so that's kind of the innovation, if you would, right, that we're talking about today. And in the process of that innovation, then the empowerment it gives to any role group, in this case a principal role group, in formulating what it is that we're going to be doing moving forward. Okay. So the first thing we start is with what we call ideal state. Okay. And it's really good at putting up pictures. So we always have to start off talking about, okay, so if things are ideal and really good, right, what would that look like? Right, so if we had our ideal DOE system that was empowering, right, that created innovative and creative solutions, right, that created students that were ready for 21st century jobs, right? What would that look like, right? So again, principals in the audience sat down, and we actually do use post-its, like other processes too. And then we crafted, right, statements that reflected the audience's ideal state. The next thing we do in the process is we talk about, well, what are the things that are preventing us from getting it? So it actually is a deficit model, is what we describe it as, because if we were at the ideal state, then there may not be a need to try to do something different, right? But clearly, we have an ideal state and we're not there yet. And so what are the issues surrounding why we're not at the ideal state? So this is the general affinity charting. Again, use post-it notes that people start to write their ideas down. Well, here's why we're not where we're supposed to be, right? We try to limit it to one idea per post-it note, right? So that when we do the analysis, it's clear and it's easier to get commonality, right? So many of you are familiar with this part. It looks very much like brainstorming, if you would. If there's a question, everybody has ideas, they write it down, put it up, right? Then we affinity chart it, so we circle similarities. Oh, there you go, right? So lassoing, people have seen that before, you lasso similar ideas, okay? Now, where it gets different is then the same people that came up with these ideas do what we call interrelational charting. And that's where you see the lines going in and out of the circles, right? So a lot of times, again, when you go to a meeting, you get up to the point where you put your ideas down on paper, you gather them, and all the similar ones are kind of together, right? And all the similar ideas are over here, right? It's the next step that kind of separates it. Because now, as a participant, right, I get to determine whether this idea causes this idea. And we start to create relationships within the chart. And you can see how messy it gets with lines, right? When one idea causes another, you draw an arrow from one to the other, you put the bullet at the end, and you put the arrowhead on this side, right? Because at the end of the day, we're gonna tally up what we call the ins and outs. So the end of the arrow is that round circle, right? And those are all the outs, and then the arrowhead are the ins. Right? Because then we're going to do something that's called Pareto charting, which sort of looks like that, where you start to count the number of ins and outs, right? And when you look at the ins and outs, the outs are what we call the root cause. So now you can actually line up what the root causes are to why we are not achieving the ideal state. Okay? And all of this, again, is done by the participants in the room, right? You can have a small group of participants, or you can have a large group of participants, right? But it's not any longer where your ideas are sent somewhere, and some other people now are fooling around with your ideas and figuring out what it is that you're saying, and then putting it out back to you. Say, well, here's what you said, right? And here's what we're gonna do based on what you said, okay? So, in essence, the first part of the Hoshin process, we identify the issue, right, about why we're not getting, reaching that ideal state, right? Issue identification is kind of takes a whole day process, right? Then this additional piece goes into solution generation. So if this is the root cause of why we're not getting it, then what are the solutions, the possible solutions that we can undertake to address those root causes, right? And it's a similar process with post-it notes, putting it up, you know, gathering the ideas, interrelational, again, Pareto, you can come up with your best solution, okay? And so when you create now a plan as to how we're gonna improve, right, the people that created all of this information are the ones that actually work on not just the issue, but the solution. So when we create now a plan, an implementation plan, right, it's no longer somebody out there that figured out, okay, here's what the problem is, okay, here's what we're gonna do about it, okay, we'll go tell the principals, because now they can go implement at their school, right? This is actually principals that did, went through that whole process, determined what the issue was, determined the best solution is, and now we are deciding as a principal group what it is that we can do to implement at our school. Okay, so again, a different process, right, that yields different results, right, that really represents the voice of whatever group it is. So in this case, the principal group, right? Imagine the power if we can galvanize that for the teacher group and or down to the student group, right? Because when you talk about the level of implementation closest to where the rubber meets the road, the term in Hoshin is Gemba, the floor, right? That's students, teachers and students working. So if we can galvanize their voice and implement their ideas into the plan that we're gonna use at our school, or the plan that we'll use in our complex area, island, state, right? Then truly that becomes empowering, right, for the people that were involved in that process. Which again, I believe is different from, right, what is currently being used by status quo, where we're still being told, right, based on your input, here's what you said, and here's what we're gonna do about it. Okay, so Tony Wagner is very clear, well, it's not compliance, right? For us, we talk about commitment, right? So it's not, okay, here's what somebody figured out, we need to comply and do what it says, right? Now we created this plan, so we're committed to seeing it through. Okay? So again, very different empowerment piece, and just through the use of different tools, right? Not the status quo that is being formulated. So that whole process, when we run it through, and train, actually takes 2 or more days to train. So obviously running you through an activity at that magnitude wouldn't work in this city. But there is something else that we are going to have you do as an activity, right? Sitting and getting is just not our style, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to talk about flight time. So flight time is another term that we use in Hoshin that talks about when the start of initiative is, and when the end of that initiative is, right? Because it, again, seems important for everybody in an organization to know, well, here's the new initiative, here's where it starts, and here's where it ends. And at the end, we have a measure to say how well we did, right? That's going to inform the next flight time about where we're gonna start and where we're gonna end, okay? Now, think about some of the initiatives on DOE, okay? Do we really know the beginning of flight time and the end of flight time? So I'm gonna pass out these post-it notes. You can just take some.
Handout.
It is a, we kind of are, he's explaining, this is an example of one of the areas we looked at for school leadership. So, but Mike is going to talk about now in terms of the flight time, and when is the end of college career readiness? Okay, so beginning of flight time for college and career readiness, and end of flight time for college and career readiness. So 2 post-it notes, okay, keep your idea as simple as possible. What would represent the beginning of flight time? What would represent the end of flight time? When you're done, I'd like you to come up to this pink sheet and you put your beginning of flight time post-it note on the left side, right? And you put your end of flight time, end of college career readiness on the right side. Okay. take a few minutes.
Okay, so good suggestion. We're actually going to put up two.
This begins the beginning of flight time and where college preparedness ends. Right? So again, your best understanding. Right? Beginning is on this side, end is on this side. So people thought that when I brought up Deming, I'll talk about code of quality management, right? Because, right? But again, referencing what Tony Wagner said this morning, right? It's not about what you know. It's about what you do with what you know, right? So this is more about what we do with what we learned about the Hoshin process, okay? So, yeah, the idea isn't that we could teach you the Hoshin process. Right? But the idea is, what are we going to do with what we know? Okay? So, the next thing we're going to do real quickly is I'm going to, because it's more people than we anticipated, which is great, I'm going to call up a couple roles, right? And what you're going to do is you're going to come up and one group will be here in this room. It's the beginning of flight time, right? And we encourage this to be done without talking. Okay, there's a lot of time to talk after, but initially it's about not talking. One of the reasons why we talk about not talking is because in a usual brainstorm kind of situation, who are the ones who usually speak up and talk? It's the ones who are inclined to do that. And the vast majority of people we found sit quietly and watch, right? So even though it's a brainstorm and everybody supposedly has a chance to put their two cents in, right? What we actually get in a brainstorm is a few people that get their two cents in and the rest of the people. And so when we talk about not talking initially, it's to encourage everybody, right, to put their two cents to actually interact with the information. So what we want is the people that come to this group and look at the beginning of flight time to kind of without talking, take the different ideas that you see and kind of start to group them. So I put this here. And oh, that's sort of like this. So I put it here. Oh, that's sort of like this. Oh, no, like this one. Right? When I call up the next group, they actually have a chance to look at what people did and say, well, no, you know. It's encouraging the interaction with the actual information that we have. Right? And being able to do something about it. Right? If you don't agree with this group, kind of looks like it's the same. I have the same power, authority, whatever, to take it and put it into another group, right? And we do this several times until we kind of come up with the general idea of what we're doing. So let me take first the first three rows here, because there's only one person. And you guys go to the end of flight time and look at that. Kind of take the three rows here, so we're kind of dividing the rows in half, and you guys come up here. So you guys stand around the paper, right? And start to think, right? Everybody should have a chance to come up, look at the post-it notes, and move them around. Okay? Okay, so first three rows here, the first three rows here. Come up.
How much time are they
using? Okay, well let's say we'll give you 4 minutes. So look at all the post-it notes, kind of put them together. You see personalities come up real quickly because some people like the post-it notes all nice and neat, and other people don't care. So you get the nice and neat people.
Should not be one person touching all the post-it notes. It should be like everybody having a chance to Google post-it notes.
Exactly. You can spread it out over the whole sheet.
Different people have to move the post-it notes, okay?
Again, just a tip, right? We found it better to work on a wall, right, than on a table, right? Because somehow standing up and looking at the wall is better than standing around the table looking down at it. OK, Okay, if you've been up front moving post-it notes, make way for people in the back so that they can come up front. Make sure that you had a chance to touch the post-it notes.
Okay, those that did not come up, now's your turn.
So take a look at what the group before you did. Again, you have a right to move any of those post-it notes any way you want. Okay, just because somebody else put it somewhere doesn't mean that you can't move it. See people on this side, maybe there's only four.
Some can move on to this side.
Okay, remember this is the beginning of flight time, end of flight time, college career end. So a couple things to note, right? College and career readiness, one could argue, is a really important initiative in the Department of Education, right? I mean, we spend a lot of time talking about curriculum stress assessment and what are we doing and how are we getting kids college and career ready, right? In that initiative, you think, knowing what the beginning of that initiative is, and especially then what is the end, would be important to know, right? Because it's important and we're all working on it, right? And if we're gonna be able to measure something at the end so that informs our next steps, again, it would be good to know what that end is, okay? But when you look at these things, you can kind of see already that this appears to be three, four groups. So four different ideas in. And if you look at that group, at least three, it looks like there's a couple outliers though of when the end of college and career readiness is. So again, as we think about it in the department, well, how are we gonna work on this? How are we gonna get better at it if we don't even know when it ends? And how are we gonna measure it when we don't know when it ends? Okay, so again, part of the processes that we use, right, and determined by the people that developed it, is this beginning and end of flight time. So let me just read one group. So beginning, so one, I have fifth grade, eighth grade, sixth grade, ninth grade. So one could argue that, okay, they're all grade levels, so that seems like, but one could argue that these are all different, because fifth grade is the beginning of flight time. Oh no, eighth grade. This is the beginning of flight. Sixth grade is the beginning of flight time. And ninth grade is the beginning of flight time. Okay. So again, just by the process, right, we can actually see, well, there is no consensus. When are we beginning college and career readiness? We don't know where to begin. Well, let's go see where we end. I'm kind of looking at this.
While he's looking, have you considered that today's, they say the millennials will change their careers how many times? So it's not the traditional, went to college to be a teacher, and I'm a teacher forever.
So the end is years into college, or years into career. This one is 20 years old, by the year 2025. The end is during your career. Oh, here's a good one. The end is retirement. So we need to measure when people retire to determine what the next step is going to be in college and career readiness. Okay? It's unending. So we now have an initiative that never ends, okay? So again, just by this example, right, and when you talk about processes that can yield different results, right, this is just an example of a process that shows, right, some of the downside of what we've been doing in the DOE. And might there be better processes in place that will help students, teachers, principals, school to make better choices about how we're going to move forward, right? Think about what would happen if, as an initiative, we picked innovation, right? Because that's, again, topic of this conference, right? When does innovation start? When does innovation end as an initiative? And again, I think you can already see that defining that, looking at ideal state, looking at barriers that will get in the way of achieving that ideal state, actually coming out with issues, right, that surround that versus solutions that will help, right? Now we can create a plan that has a start and an end that we can measure and that we can now plan next steps on, okay? To me, it's pretty clear, right, that there are processes that we have not tried as a department, that principals have not tried at their schools, that teachers have not tried in their classroom, that we don't even allow students, as they're working on their own projects, to use or learn, right? That might be a better way to do what we're doing, right? Might be a better way to achieve the ends that we think are important for us to achieve, okay? So this is the process that we were able to take principals through, and Naomi actually is going to kind of go over the results of trying to get you out by 12:20 in lunch. Okay. But again, just a little example of what a process can do. Okay.
So there's another green handout, and I'm just going to kind of just walk you really fast through it because Mike did a really great job on explaining it. So did Lorilei and Shannon. But when we did our research at the beginning, we decided when we looked at ESSA, the law, we said, what does the law say? We found seven, which you call buckets. And they were like, we should be addressing curriculum standards, setting up systems of school level accountability, et cetera, they're listed in the bulletin. Then we went through the process to identify the ideal state of the buckets, which was supporting school leadership. So ESSA clearly says that money should be used to support school leadership. So this is one example. So we identified the ideal state, and I kind of listed all the post-its there. We identified the root cause, what's preventing us from having that ideal state. We took one of, we looked at the probable root causes, because there were many. We selected one possible root cause. And we started the process of looking at solutions. We identified, we had many, because there were many post-its, but we agreed that we would focus on one of the solutions. So that's one possible high-value solution. So, you know, what should be in your mind is that that's not the only answer, and there's not one answer to solve a problem, but this is the path for one of those solutions. So if you think statewide, or even complex area or school, you have many things you need to address. But do we have a plan for each of those initiatives? And the next page over is what he started to talk about, which is the next steps. So this is where we are as a principal group. We took one possible solution, call it a high value solution, we defined it. We started to work out a process so we could come up with, as Mike has said, what do we expect at the beginning? What is the situation now for that solution? And where do we want to be? What is the moment of truth that tells us we've arrived? And for each of those steps, we broke it down. We looked at what is the evidence at the end of that step that says we've completed that step and we can go on to the next step. So again, using the example of the support for school level leadership. Okay, so the other pages is kind of like a running notes that we did in terms of the whole process. So you won't have time to read it, but when you have nothing to do and you're bored and you wanted to know what we do, you kind of read those notes and get a picture and capture what we've gone through. We've had many principals come in and out because we know principals have nothing to do, so they really have a lot to do, so we appreciate it, even if they could come to one meeting. And we had principals like Mark who came in from the neighbor island at his own expense, participate in the process, so that we truly appreciate that we had that wide range of input from principals. We also had retired principals say, hey, can I come in, you know? I think I still know something about education and I might be able to contribute, so we welcome that as well. We also have community people want to join us, district superintendents. You know, it's just, you know, great to have everybody involved in the process. Next step, if you have a post-it and you would like to be contacted so you can be involved in the process, because we're, you know, like I showed you just one, we have six more to go. And we really are determined to have information that represents your voice given to the Department of Education, who has asked us for it, the Education Institute of Hawaii, who has asked us for it, the Governor's Task Force, who asked us for this information. So, you know, it makes us feel good that all our hard work, people are interested in knowing what we're doing. The board members also asked us to present, which we did, and they said, we want to see the end product. So, oh my God, pressure. But, you know, we really would like to have most of you involved, and if you can. And if you can't come, that's fine. But if you are willing to be part of the process in some way, you write your name on a post-it and turn it in to either one of us, and we will make sure we communicate with you. So Lorilei is going to do question and answer. I think we have a few minutes.
So we have about 6 minutes, but I'll let you gather your thoughts because I just wanted to acknowledge a few people. So as Naomi mentioned, I'd like to acknowledge Mark Hackelberg, principal at KE, right? Intermediate, who joined us and was part of our work session, as well as Laura Vines from Kalihi Kai, who also was part of our session. And there were a lot of you who sometimes we did, who, Debbie? Where's Debbie?
Did you come to
our
meeting?
No.
Oh, but thank you, Debbie. Sometimes we did things through Google Hangouts and we didn't get you identified. So if you were a part of that, raise your hand and we'd like to acknowledge you. Okay, and then lastly, I'd like to acknowledge Estelle Wong, who is our HASA board, one of our HASA board members, actually the treasurer. So she's kind of important. So thank you, Estelle, for being here. Okay. So now that I talked, if you could gather your thoughts and questions.
You have a box on page 2 of the evidence. How far have you folks gotten to, because that is, the moment of truth is the actual document or instrument or the result of that step. So I'm wondering if you've identified those evidence that will demonstrate that that has been fulfilled.
So we didn't go through the entire process with any one of, well, we finished one, right? So we did one, but the rest of the buckets, we still need to finalize and get to that point.
Yeah, this one on the bottom here, mm-hmm. Evidence. So that would be, you know, what would that look like? Like, can you give us an example of what
sure.
Step 7, moment of truth, would look like?
Do
what
we have
evidence?
We have the one for leadership that we.
No, I didn't know that.
Oh. We'll take a look at the exact words for you and one of them.
So I could just kind of, so quickly, so again, in an implementation plan, we call it a 7-step process,
mm-hmm.
right? And at the end of each of the steps, we have what we call the moment of truth, when
mm-hmm.
we know there's evidence, there's a measurement, there's something that we know, we're ready to move to the next step,
mm-hmm.
right? And so again, the process that I described clearly takes a long time, right? So if you're wanting to figure out something in a day, push-in is not what you're going to use, okay? So if you look at, again, what it says, so when principals, teachers, parents, students feel that they are in control or and supported in what happens at their school, okay, this might be something like a survey, right, that you give, or it might be able to point to a project that was a school-developed or school-initiated project that was able to be taken from beginning to end, right? And the school feels like that was important for us to get done, right? So there's a lot of moments of truth, right? So if it were like, for me, I'm trying to build this audio studio, right? When I cut that ribbon to the door for our audio studio, that's a moment of truth for me to say, yes, we accomplished this task, right? So Yeah, Lorilei said that we haven't yet worked through all of these implementation plans. And it's clearly something that we intend to do.
Thank you. Roberta?
You already addressed it. I wondered how many buckets you addressed. You indicated just the one.
We have seven buckets, and they're on here on page.
What page is it? First page.
It's listed.
Page two.
Page two. On page two, there's the content seven buckets. And we actually got that the essential parts of the ESSA law, but we also got it from going to the governor's blueprint meetings, and so it kind of correlates with those buckets also.
On your post-it, if you would like the full document, you know, let us know. I mean, this is like ideas to be shared out, so let us know what you know.
Page 4 and 5 show the buckets.
Oh, 4 and 5 show more details of the buckets then. Any other questions? Dale?
How do you account for the stakeholder changes? So, you know, as stakeholders change, whether they come in, they come out, and the process is moving forward, and I guess it's somewhat related to the question about evidence. Because then to what degree does that evidence reflect the stakeholders when there's fluidity?
Right. So that has actually been a positive for us, because at the stages that we're at, every time we get somebody new, we get to summarize and clarify and then hear their opinions. And actually all the principals basically have the same concerns. Some have innovative ideas that they've created at their schools that they were about to share with everyone, which changed things. But basically, when that happens, we get new stakeholders in, then we get new ideas, but it actually is correlated to what has already been there so far. So it's kind of enhanced it.
So it's 12 points. All right. So I'm going to end this with one more exercise. Quick. Okay, it's about perspective, right? Because one of the things that we always talk about as well is perspective, right? So everybody has a different perspective. Here's what I want you to do to see, right? Put your right or left hand up, your dominant hand, your finger pointing up, right? And I want you to start going in a circle, clockwise, okay? Right? Clockwise, right? So 12 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 9 o'clock, right? Okay, now I want you to slowly, right, move your hand down so that now the circle is in front of you. And you can see that it's still going clockwise, right? Now keep going, now move that circle down, and what you see is still going clockwise. So while it seems like your perspective has changed because you went from here to here, to here, actually your perspective is the same because you're still looking at it from the bottom of the circle. Now try to do this. Same thing. Circle. Now instead of going in front of you, draw your hand down, right, so that you're going the same way, but you're now you're down here. So you're looking at top. Which way are you going? Now you're going counterclockwise. Perspective. Right? You didn't change anything. You're going clockwise. You don't change anything. All you're changing is your perspective, and now you're going counterclockwise. Okay, so sometimes again, individuals, principals, teachers, the DOE, right, can be thinking, oh yes, look, we're changing perspective, it's the same thing. Right, so we can't get caught into this idea, right, that that's what we're doing. We need to have the processes that will help us see that. Okay, so again, just a real visual reminder of what perspective can be. Okay, so with that, I'd like to thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Again, let us know if there's anything else we can do.